Dear participants, I hope majority of you are now ready and with us. At the outset, allow me to welcome you all to the first technical session of day two of the workshop. I'm proud to introduce Dr. Rumana Shehla, our first speaker today. Dr. Shehla is a young and very talented teacher working as assistant professor in the statistics section of the Women's College, Aligarh Muslim University. She has also worked as assistant professor in Banasthali Vidyapeeth, Rajasthan. Dr. Shehla, again, is a proud student of Professor Athar Ali Khan, and she has completed her PhD under his supervision in 2016. Dr. Shehla did her graduation and post-graduation in statistics from the Department of Statistics and Operation Research of AMU. She was the class topper and faculty topper in MSc in 2010 and was the recipient of the of both the department as well as faculty gold medal. She teaches many courses of statistics and she has an expertise in handling R software. Her research interests include Bayesian inference, Bayesian computing, statistical modeling, optimization, simulation, among other topics. Dr. Shehla has a good number of research publications to her credit, and I'm very sure that her expertise and rich experience in handling R software will benefit the participants. I now request Dr. Shehla to please start the session. Over to you, Dr. Shehla. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum to everyone.
Alaikum assalam.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
Just a minute, I'll share the screen first. So, are you all able to see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I'll start with one of the saying of Sir Albert Einstein. He once said that the formulation of a problem is often more essential than its solution, which may be merely a matter of mathematical or experimental skill. So, sometimes it happens that we may plug into more complex data analysis instead of paying much attention to what the objectives are and what and whether the collected data is appropriate for the proposed analysis or not. So, to formulate the problem correctly, we must understand the physical background of the data regarding the subject area from which it is coming from. Also, we must understand what the client was. Sometimes we work in collaboration with people of other subject area, and thus we must understand what the client wants or what is the objective of the analysis which is the client is expecting. And thirdly, the important part is to put the problem into statistical terms, and this particular step is the most challenging step. But once it is done, the solution is often routine. The analysis is often routine. Today, I'll deal with one of the data set which is present in the Mosaic package of R, and the data name is Help R City. This data set is a real data set, and I'll work with this, and I'll work around this to show you different type of data analysis with the use of some functions of R. So, firstly, I'll just introduce the R language. It is a language for statistical computing and graphics. best suited for it. Actually, you can do everything in R programming language, but it is best suited for statistical computing. And it is written primarily in C, Fortran, and R itself. Today, I'll show you the data set and show you some functions, huge capabilities of R for the analysis of this particular data set. The first, we will install the Mosaic package, and then we will deal with the dataset which is known as the Help RCT dataset. I'll explain the dataset first. The dataset was about the people of Boston. The people of Boston was a larger section of them were involved in drug abuse and substance abuse acts. Some were taking alcohol, some were taking cocaine, some were taking heroin. And this kind of acts resulted in the increased morbidity and increased HIV infections cases in the area. And also this, due to this, this had put large pressure on the medical care emergency department, and thus on the part of the government, it just incurred a lot of expenses. So a clinical trial was conducted in order to assess the concept of a novel multidisciplinary health clinic, which will encourage the people who are involved in this drug abuse act to link themselves to the primary care health clinic, off-site primary care health clinic. So since they were undergoing, the patients were undergoing detoxification program, but unko wo log bahut zyada primary health care ki taraf bahut zyada motivated nahi the. Just so the clinical trial was conducted in order to see whether this novel multidisciplinary health clinic procedure will help them to link these patients to the primary health care clinic or not. So the data set was completely collected for this purpose, but since we have a when we have a huge data set, then apart from the primary objective of collecting the data, we can have several secondary objective accomplished. So the primary outcome of the interest was to see whether the attendance in the primary healthcare clinic in 12 months, and the secondary outcome was to check the health related quality of life of those patients. So the data was collected for the sample was collected of the sample size was 453, and out of these number of patients, people, the two groups, there were made two groups. One group was given the treatment of health clinic, which is the multidisciplinary health clinic, and the other group was not given this clinic treatment, right? The first group was given this clinic treatment where they were with some nurse, social workers, and physicians, where they would motivate them to get linked to the primary health care clinic. And the other group was not given any this kind of treatment. And both these groups were tried to compare. And the data set is present in the Mosaic package. And you can see this data set through by the help of the function data. You can also write this name of the data set, Help RCTs, and enter it on the R console. After doing this particular thing, library, Mosaic, right? So you can see the data set, and I have shown a smaller part of this data set, and this data set consists of 30 variables. You are seeing on the screen that there are 30 variables in this data frame. 30 variables. First one is age, and like this we have 30 variables. Where out of 30, we have got 13 qualitative variables and the rest are quantitative in nature. I'll explain one or two. You can go to the help page and get a description of this data set, each of the variables, the meaning of each of the variables of this data frame, right? I'll explain one or two. This CESD is basically the scores of depressive systems, the symptoms in the patients, in the sample. And it may take value from 1 to 60, and higher score will show the worse condition of the patient. And this MCS, here it is. MCS is the mental component score. PCS is the physical component score. Days link is the number of days they required to link themselves to the primary health care clinic. Homeless gives you the is the variable which where each of the subject you are asked whether they are housed or whether they remain on the without the home, right? So these are the some of the variables I have discussed. Substance is the number, the type of the drug they are taking, whether they are alcoholic or whether they are taking cocaine or whether they are taking both of these, right? So these are the 30 variables in the data frame. Now we will first move for the initial data analysis. Generally, when we have raw data in our hand, what we do, we first try to see whether the data was collected in the form, data was collected through designed sample survey technique, or are there any missing values, or are there not any non-responses. And these all of these things are in termed as the data wrangling and data cleansing process. Generally, when we have our data, our raw data in hand, we just, for the first step is to, compulsory step is to do the data cleansing and data wrangling. Here, I will assume that this data is ready to analyze, and then we will move for the data analysis part. First, we will look into the numerical summaries of some of the variables in this data set. Let's consider the CESD score, and we will we'll compute the mean of this CESD score of all the patients or of all the subjects in the sample which we have, and this can be done with the function mean. This function is available in the base system of R. However, this mosaic package again gives you a mean function which actually has a formula interface. This particular tilde CESD can be used, and this pipe operator can be used to find the mean of average CESD scores for both the groups, right? So we are getting, and we have to specify the data from which we are picking this data. So we have to specify the name of the data frame. This is the way we calculate the mean CESD scores with respect to the gender. So the average CESD score for female in the whole sample was 36.88, and for the male it is 31.59. So you can easily conclude that the average CESD scores of female is significantly higher than the male average score. Similarly, you can use this pipe operator in the mean function in order to get the average CESD scores for both the groups, the substance group and the sex group. So you are getting the results like alcohol.female. Right, number, the average CESD scores of the average CESD scores of the female who were alcoholic, the average CESD scores of the female who were taking cocaine, the average CESD score who were female who were taking heroin. So in the same way, you are getting the average CESD scores for all the male groups and by the type of substance they are actually consuming. Similarly, we can have the average age of the people who were considered in the sample by the substance and split by substance and their gender. The function FabStats is also available in the package Mosaic, which actually uses a formula interface and gives you the five number summary. The five number summary includes the minimum value, the first quartile, that is the value below which 25% of the observations lie, and then the median, then third quartile, the maximum, and the mean also. Here, number of subjects were also included, and the number of missing observations were also included. So this FabStats gives you a brief summary of the CESD scores by sex and substance group. Now we will move on to the visualization of this data. We'll pick some of the variables and we will try to visualize this using some of the functions in the ggformula package. And there are several functions in the base system of R also for visualizing the data, like hist, like box plot, like point plot. But here in the ggformula, we have a formula interface. And this ggformula package is an improvement over ggplot2 package, where it actually gives you the wrap wrapper of the functions which we have in GT2 plot 2 package, and it gives you the refined plots. It beautifies the plot. So the basic template is gf_plot_type. Here you just have to mention the type of plot you need to draw, and then you have to give the formula, and then you have to mention the data. So here you are seeing this pipe operator, right? This pipe operator is basically one of the main feature of GVT formula package. Actually, it is also defined in the package Magritte R. This pipe operator, what it does, it actually considers the output of the first function as an argument in the second function. Actually, stacking functions inside of each other is a very, makes the code quite unreadable. So this pipe operator, what it does, it actually takes the output of the first function and keeps it as an argument in the second function, so that the readability of the code improves. So here I will show you how I drew the histogram of this CEST scores and use this pipe operator in order to make many customizations in this plot. Right, gf_histogram is the function to draw the histogram. Here I have taken the CESD scores from the data, helps RCTC, and bin width give the width of the bins, the intervals, right? With the call argument, we can specify the color in the plot which we want to have. Fill equal to blue fills the each and every bar of the histogram, right? So line type equal to 2, actually when I have put line type equal to 2, it has given the dashed line around the all the bins, right? So you can have different kinds of customization. Here with this pipe operator, I have made many customizations in this plot, right? If you write this command till this bracket, then what will happen? It will take the make the titles of the axis by default. But if you want to increase the size font, and if you want to change the font of the titles, subtitles, or the axis titles, or the main title, then you must use this function theme and element_text. Which will help you to customize the size of this, customize the font, customize the size of this text on the axis, and all, as well as in the main title, right? And with this facet_wrap, what I have done, I have given a formula interface. What is this doing? It is actually making the plots in two rows where the CESD scores are shown, the histogram of CESD scores are shown by the gender. You are getting the histogram of CESD scores for female and for male, right? And these two histograms are placed in two rows. And if you want to see this, if you want to have the same, these two plots side by side, you just have to, remove this gf_facet_wrap and just put in the gf histogram function, you just have to put this tilde CESD pipe operator, vertical bar from the keyboard, and write down the sex variable here. So it will place, it will make the histogram for both the groups, and it will place the histogram side by side. But what I am doing, I am placing these two, what I want, I want these two histograms to be placed one upon each other. So in order to do that, there is a provision of using this function and then make different number of rows for different groups. One disadvantage of histogram is that you are restricted to using the number of bins to mention the number of bins, right? In order to get rid of this disadvantage, what we try to make a density histogram, right? Density curve. Here, what I have done, I have used the function gf underscore d histogram, which gives you densities on the y-axis. You can see that here we have counts on the y-axis, right? Which is generally done while drawing any histogram. We have the number of counts here, and the area of each of the bean is proportional to the number of frequencies, right? So in order to have the densities on the y-axis, we can use the function gf underscore d histogram, right? And then with the pipe operator, we can use different functions, which will, this pipe operator will make this thing, the first function, as an argument in the second function. And with the element underscore text, we will customize the size of this title. Now, what I have done with another pipe operator in this same command, I have just overlaid a normal density curve on this plot by the function gf underscore fit dist r. And what I have done with the function vline, I have just put a vertical line on this same plot. Yesterday, Athasar discussed that the curve is the function in which if we add equal to true argument, then it can make changes on the existing plot, right? So here in the ggformula package, we have several other ways to do this, several other functions and several other ways to do this, to make changes on the existing plot. Now, when we have a categorical variable and we want to have a plot which actually is between a categorical variable and a quantitative variable, then we can have a box plot, where box plot can be made in the same way as we had the histogram. We just have to write what the kind of plot we want, gf underscore box plot. So R is a functional language. For everything you have a function, and to know the, I mean, whatever task we are doing, the function name is almost similar to that task. So to draw the box plot, we have the function box plot from the ggformula package. So here, what I am doing, I am again giving a formula interface where we are making the box plot, the plot for the two groups. For the CSD scores for the two groups. Here, what box plot summarizes? It gives you the median with this vertical line, the median line. And these are these two boundaries of the box depicts the quartile, first quartile and the third quartile, and these lines are called the whiskers, right? So again, with the theme function, I have customized this plot and changed the size of the, by default it will take CSD on x-axis and sex on the y-axis, by default it will take, but if you want to change the customize it, if you want to change the size, if you want to change the text or face, font size and face and colors, you can customize it with the theme function. Now, if you have the sample size, a small sample size, then instead of drawing a box plot, you can also opt for the point plot. Now, in order to show that, I have just extracted 20 rows from the data frame help RCT. 20 rows. Now this data sample is a small sample, and I have shown how this can be, on this sample we can draw a point plot. And this, the function for this is gf underscore point. Here, what I have done, I have plotted the CESD score by substance group. Just you have to put the substance variable after till, and you will get the point plot here between the CST score and the substance group. So here this is, so you are seeing the substance on the x-axis and CST on scores on the y-axis. So with this GG formula package, we are able to draw refined plots. The look of the plots are much more better than the plots we can build with the with some functions of the which is available in the base system of R. Now we all of these were about the descriptive statistics where we found the mean, we found the SD, we found the different quartiles. But sometimes we want to have the inferential statistics. What statistical inference is, we just on the basis of the sample, we want to draw conclusions from the population on the basis of the sample data. And the statistical inference is consists of two main things. The first, in the first portion, what we do estimation, and in the second category, we will do the testing of hypothesis. So I think all of you must be knowing what hypothesis are. It is just a claim about the population parameter. We first make a claim about the population, and we, on the basis of the sample data, what we try to do, we try to test whether our sample data is close to our hypothesis or not. If it is close to the hypothesis is accepted. If it is not close to the hypothesis, if it is not providing a good evidence regarding the claim, then we reject it, right? It is the same thing, jaise ki hum court mein, most of us have never been to court, alhamdulillah. जब हम कोर्ट गए, लेकिन हमने फिल्मों में देखा होगा कि कोर्ट में कभी भी जो मुकदमे होते हैं उसका जो फाइनल वर्डिक्ट दिया जाता है, तो वो इसी तरह से दिया जाता है कि तमाम सबूतों के को मद्देनजर रखते हुए हम मुल्ज़िम को बाइज़्ज़त बरी करते हैं या हम मुल्ज़िम को कसूरवार ठहराते हैं, इस टाइप की कोई चीज़. तो सिमिलरली वॉट वी आर डूइंग हियर, वी आर ऑन द सैम्पल विच वी हैव इन आवर हैंड, वी ट्राई टू चेक. We first make a claim regarding the population parameter, whether it is about the population mean, whether it is about the population correlation coefficient, or whether it is about the population variance. We make a claim, we make a statement, and then we have the data. On the basis of the data, we try to reject that claim or we try to accept that claim. We try to see whether our sample data is providing enough evidence to support the claim, right? So we have several test procedures in our statistical literature, like Z test, T test, chi square test, F test, for this testing of hypothesis. So we will learn here how these testing can be done using the functions of R. Firstly, here we are considering a single sample, and here I want to check test whether the average CESD scores of all the females. Here I have used the filter function in order to extract the observations from the data on all the variables for just the female subjects, excluding the male subjects. We are trying to test whether the average CESD scores of all the female objects in the sample is significantly different from zero. So for testing this, we are implementing the function t.test. The t.test is already available in the base system of R. You can use that. But the t.test, which is available in the Mosaic package, it is a wrapper of the function t.test, which is present in the base system of R. It's just the wrapper. It provides a provision for giving the form, having the formula interface. So here what we have done, we have just picked the CESD from the data frame, female, which is the data frame for the female subjects from the help RCT data frame. And the result we are seeing that the alternative, we always have to specify the alternatives while testing hypothesis, a null hypothesis. So the alternative was that true mean is not equal to zero. And what we are seeing here, we are seeing that we are rejecting H naught. Here we are seeing that P value is less than 0.05. If we are considering the level of significance as 5%, then we are going to reject the claim that the population CESD scores for the females in the whole population is zero. So this same thing can be done using the bootstrap method. To implement the bootstrap method, we have used the function resample, right? What it does, it is resampling from the sample data, resampling the female observations from the sample data, and then computing the mean repeatedly. And we are doing it for 1,000 times. And we are seeing these results. I have just shown five results from the results which I have stored in the trials object, right? And after that, we can find the 95% confidence interval for these mean values, mean CESD scores. And we are seeing that it doesn't contain zero, and thus we are going to reject H1. So these two things are just alternatives. Like, yeah, this is the first thing, and this is by simulation, right? So suppose we in the next step, we want to test whether half of the population who were involved in drug abuse were homeless or not, right? We want to check, test whether half of the population who were involved in drug abuse act were homeless. And in order to test this, we are implementing the binom.test function. What it does, the binom.test function is basically present in the R system, base system of R, but it requires to specify the number of people, number of successes. The success is the event in which we are interested. Here we are interested in the number of people who are homeless, and then to specify the total number of subjects under study. But in the binom.test in the mosaic package, you are able to specify this using the formula interface. You just don't have to count the number of successes. You just have to mention the name and specify the variable, value, specific value, and then put the data, name of the data, and you will get the result. I'm storing this result in the result object, and we are able to get this result. And here also we are seeing that p-value is less. Here we are actually seeing that p-value is greater than 0.05. So we are going to accept, and we will conclude that we accept, or we say that we do not reject, and we are going to conclude at 5% level of significance that half of the population who were involved in this drug abuse activity in the whole area of Boston were homeless. Right? After that, if our
Dr. Rumana, may I please request you to please increase the font size to have the better visibility. Okay.
Is it clear now?
Yes, much better.
Okay. So now, suppose our objective is to test whether there is an equal proportion of people in each substance group, like in alcohol group or in cocaine group or in heroin group, whether there is an equal proportion of people in each substance group in the population. And we have to test this on the basis of our sample data. So how will you test this? This can be tested using the chi-square test, and the function for this is chi-sq.test. First of all, what we will do, we will first of all find out the number of people who were in these three different groups, right? Here we are taking both the male and female group, the total data set, the total number of subjects which we had in the sample, we are considering all of that. What we are doing with the function tally, we are actually trying to get the number of people who were in this three groups. And format equal to count gives the counts. If you change this option, you can have the percentages, you can have the proportions also here by specifying those in the format argument. So I have just specified the count, and I have just the count of the number of the people in each substance group here. So this is the manual work which we do. We count this observed number of people, and then we calculate this expected value, and then we do this chi-sq.test. We implement this chi-sq.test observed, and then the p equal to p, and then we get the result. Now, this is the p value, and here also we are what we are getting, we are just getting the p value less than 0.05, and so we are going to reject H0, and we are going to say that, conclude that there is an reject H0, and we are going to conclude that there isn't, sorry, I have written, sorry, wrong conclusion. So we are going to reject H0, and we are saying that there was unequal proportion of subject in each substance abuse group in the whole original population. So what we are trying to do, we are seeing this sample data, and we are trying to conclude about the population on the basis of this data by this testing procedures, right? Now we can move on to the inference for two samples and implement this. We will first implement the t dot test function in order to see whether the average CESD scores for both the female and male groups were same in the original population, right? It was something somewhat different in the sample because we have just had the average CESD scores for both the male and female in the, by using the mean function. Now we want to test whether it was in the same in the original population or not. And what we are getting a p-value of which is very much less than 0.05, and we are going to reject H0. And what we are concluding? We are concluding that the average CESD scores of female subjects were higher than the male subjects, right, for this data set. In the same way, we can have the test of association, just a minute, where we want to, we may want to have this kind of objective, like to test whether the substance abuse preferences differ by gender in the whole population. And for this, what we are doing, we are just using the chi-sq.test function, and we are using internally, we are using the tally function, and the formula interface is substance till subject, right? We are having these two two variables here in the tally function. Margins equal to false means we are not interested in getting the marginal probabilities, and the data is specified here, right? So what we are getting, we are getting the p-value as p-value greater than 0.05, and here we are going to not reject H0, and we are concluding that the choice of the choice between alcohol, cocaine and heroin doesn't depend on the gender and the overall population, right? Similarly, we have this alternate function for this testing using the chi-square test. The function is xchi-sq.test, which is available in the Mosaic package. And here, what is the advantage of using this function is that we are, just a minute, here we are getting more, I mean, this function reports more number of summaries, like it is reporting the actual observed value and also the expected value. So this is reporting much number of summaries compared to this. So we can also use this function also from the Mosaic package, and thus we are here rejecting, we are here accepting it, right? There is an alternative to the two-group t-test, which is the non-parametric alternative, which actually uses the concept of distribution-free testing procedure, right? In all the t-tests, the initial assumption is that the parent population should be normal. However, the t-test is very robust. If it deviates from normality, even then you can use t-test because it is a very robust testing technique. But the non-parametric alternative to t-test is also available in R, for which the function is wilcox.test, and you can have this formula interface to get the same conclusion, right? Now suppose if you have two continuous variables and you want to see whether there is any kind of relationship between these two variables or not, so you can make a scatter plot for this particular purpose. The scatter plot can be made from the function, by the function gf underscore, just a minute, gs underscore point, and you can have these two continuous variables in the as the first argument in the formula interface, and you can just get the scatter plot. Now what I have done, I have tried to use this smooth function in order to do the smoothing of this line, and also this particular shaded region is gives you the confidence interval of this line. Like by specifying SE equal to true, I am getting the confidence region also. Right, size equal to 2 is basically actually making this the increasing the thickness of this line. So this particular scatter plot is showing that, depicting that there is a, I think I have just, something is wrong with this card. Yes, just a minute. Let me go to the, I think I just compiled the wrong command with this scatter plot. No, it's correct. Okay, thank you. So this is the scatter plot between CESD scores and mental component score of the subjects in the sample, and here we are getting a closely linear relationship between the CESD scores and mental component scores of the samples which we had in the subjects which we had in the sample. So what we can do, we can compute the correlation coefficient, and we can quantify the strength of the linear relationship between the CESD scores and the MCS of the subject in the sample. And what we are getting with the function correlation, we are getting the correlation as minus 0.67. So we are getting a negative correlation between correlation coefficient between the CESD scores and the mental component scores. And that's what we actually want to see, right? The say, depressive symptoms scores is inversely proportional to the mental component score. When the mental component score is high, obviously the depressive symptoms scores will also be low, right? So we are getting a negative correlation between these two variables. Also, if we want to have more than two variables in the scatter plot, we can opt for a pairs plot. And this pairs plot can be generated with the function pairs, where you have to mention the data which consists of the more than two variables, right? Here with the select function, I have created a new data frame from the female data frame, which actually consisted of the values of all the variables for just the female subjects, and then I have selected from this female data frame, I have selected these three columns, right? Columns, CESD, MCS, and PCS. And for these three variables at once, we can generate a scatter plot by using pairs function. I have made two scatter plots side by side. This pairs function is available in the GG formula function package. And this GG pairs function is available in the GG ELIF package. You have to install this. I have just commented this because I have already installed this package, and then you have, in order to use this the particular function from this, any function from this package, you must load its library. So I have put these two scatter plots side by side in order to show you that this particular scatter plot is more informative, so we can opt for this particular function, right? So this is more informative in the sense that it is also showing the curves and density curves, and also specifying the correlation coefficient between the variables, right? Also, we can do this by computing, quantifying the correlation coefficient for these three variables, where we will be getting a correlation matrix, right? The function will be the same code, but here you will have to specify the data frame consisting of two or more than two variables. Here we have specified the data frame new df, and then I have computed the Spearman's rank correlation coefficient. So you know that, you must be knowing that Spearman's rank correlation coefficient is basically most preferable for qualitative data, right? It actually takes, generally, even if you compute it for the quantitative data by converting it, ranking the values, even then the Spearman's correlation coefficient will take a value slightly lower than the Karl-Pearson correlation coefficient. So this is the correlation matrix which we are getting by method equal to Spearman. Sorry, also you can change this method. You can specify Kendall, and you can get a Kendall's rho correlation coefficient for these variables also, right? And the Kendall rho correlation coefficient is basically a non-parametric alternative to Karl-Pearson correlation coefficient, and it is more preferable to Spearman's rank correlation coefficient when you have small data size and large number of ties in the ranks. Thus, you can replace, instead of computing the Spearman ranks correlation coefficient, you can, in those cases, you can compute the Kendall rank correlation, Kendall tau correlation coefficient also, where you have to just specify method equal to Kendall, and you can get the correlation matrix for the data set which you have in your. So, I'll just complete it here only, and then continue with this data set in the next session, inshallah. Sir, I have completed my talk for today.
Okay.
We'll continue in the next session, inshallah.
Okay, fine. So now we are inviting the participants to ask the questions. Now the session is open for discussion. If any of the participants have any question, you may please ask. Participants, if you have any question, you may please ask.
Participants, if you have any query, you may ask, please.
Yes, sir, I have a query.
Okay.
Please go ahead.
Ma'am, in t-test or other test, there are inbuilt 95% confidence level. But if we have 89 or 70% or any other CI, then what is the procedure to decide for this CI in our software, like t-test or
t-test? Let me answer. The t dot test function has an argument conf dot level. You can go to the help page of t dot test function, just using the function help, and you can go through various arguments in this function t dot test, and you can specify your own confidence level in the argument, and then have the that particular percentage of confidence interval.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
I can show you. Let me show you here. Just do help of t dot test. See, to have t dot test, it is basically in the start package base system, right? So here, are you able to see?
Yes, I can see.
T dot test. right? And you have ONF dot level equal to 0.95. Here you can specify your own level and you can get your own confidence interval for the variables.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Anyone else? Anybody? The session is open for questioning. If you have any question, you may ask, please.
I have made a small document so that we can discuss more on this, right? So I'm there for discussion. Please, you can have, you can put several questions and inshallah I'll answer. So I don't think there are some more questions.
Okay. So thank you so very much, Dr. Romana Shaila, for your wonderful presentation. I hope the participants must have enjoyed this session. Since we have almost half an hour left for the next session, so I'll request all the participants to come back a little early. We'll begin at 5:30 sharp next session of day two. Till then, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
For bearing with me. Thank you.
Thank you, coordinator sir. Thank you for.